Welcome students to Nelson's English School online education program, Standard 7, Subject Social Science. Welcome students. Today we will study Chapter 5, Women Change the World from Civic. In this chapter, we will learn about status of women, education and opportunity, and breaking stereotypes. The work opportunities available for men and women are not equal because of the demands of the family and society. A woman has to make many sacrifices. Moreover, many job opportunities are considered to be more relevant for men than women. Now, fewer opportunities and rigid expectations. Now, if we are asked to have an image of a nurse, a scientist and a teacher in our mind, the result is a female for a nurse and teacher and a male as a scientist. This is because this is what we commonly see. Moreover, every job requires certain characteristics in a person. A nurse is supposed to be very patient and soft. Hence, we always expect a nurse to be a female. On the other hand, a scientist is supposed to be extraordinarily intelligent, a trait often associated with males in the society. Presuming some roles for men and some for women is also because of the roles played by the girls and women in the family and society. Since people believe in stereotypes, like many girls do not get the same encouragement and support from the family for taking up studies in engineering and medical fields. In fact, girls are expected to get married once they finish school. We live in a society where children are pressurized by the people around them. The pressure could be from adults of the family or other children of the same age group. An example of pressure specific to gender is the disapproval regarding boys crying in front of other boys are forced by the elders in the family to take up mainstream jobs, thus discouraging them from pursuing their passion in the field of art, music, etc. Now the next topic is learning for change. Now going to school is an important of our lives. When we see more and more children joining school, it seems to be very natural to go to school. But in the earlier days, the skill of reading and writing were known only to few. There were also lots of superstitions attached to the educating women. For example, two centuries ago, it was believed that educated women would bring bad luck to their husbands and hence they would become widow. Now, children used to learn the skills and activities in which their family was engaged. There were extreme gender bias in the earlier days. In communities where the male child was taught to read and write, girls were not allowed to learn the alphabet. Even the families where skills like pottery, weaving, craft, etc. were taught, the contribution of the females was only supportive and not main. For example, regarding pottery, women collected mud and prepared the earth for pots, but they did not operate the wheel. Hence, they were not seen as potters. Many new ideas about education and learning emerged in the 19th century. Schools became more common. Many communities that were earlier not sending their children to school started sending them to school for formal education. There was a lot of resistance regarding educating women. With a lot of effort of many women and men, schools were open for girls. Females struggled to read and write. Now the next topic is breaking stereotypes. There are so many examples. I have given here some examples. One of that, Lakshmi Lakra. 27 years old Lakshmi Lakra from a poor family in a tribal village in Jharkhand is the first woman engine driver for Northern Railways. The second is Ramabai, from 1858 to 1922, and she championed the cause of women's education. she was given the title Pandita. She was because she could read and write Sanskrit. She never went to school. She learned to read and write from her parents. She set up a mission which is still active today near Pune in 1898, where poor women and widows were encouraged to become literate and independent. Now the next is Rasasundari Devi from 1800 to 1890. And her autobiography in Bangla titled Amar Jeevan is the first known autobiography written by an Indian woman. She used to secretly take out pages from the books of her son and husband. She learned by matching the letters or words with the ones she remembered or heard during the course of her days. Now, through her own writing, she could express and let the world know about women's lives in those days. Now, the next is Rokaya Shekhawat Hussain. Rokaya Shekhawat Hussain. She knew how to read and write Urdu, but was not allowed to learn Bangla and English. She learned these with the help of her brother and sister. She became a writer and wrote a remarkable story titled Sultana's Dream in 1905. In 1910, she also started a school for girls in Kolkata, which is still functioning today. Now the next is schooling and education today. Many boys and girls attend school today, but there still remains a difference in the education levels of boys and girls. The dropout rate of girls is very high, especially in rural areas, and this is due to the circumstances and the attitude of the family and society, wherein girls are expected to take care of the house and their siblings and elders. It is also due to inadequate facilities at school, like availability of toilets. Now, these tables shows that though the number of literate men and women has increased significantly over the years, the gap between the education levels of men and women has not gone away. Now, providing equal schooling facilities to children from all communities and classes, and particularly girls, still continues to be a challenge in our country. Now, from the data of the Education Survey Government of India 2003 and 4, we can conclude that girls from SC and ST category leave school at a higher rate than the other girls. The rate at which girls leave school is higher than that of boys. The rate of leaving school at the secondary level is the highest. The 2001 census also found that the rate at which Muslim girls leave school is higher than that of Dalit, means officially called Scheduled Caste SC, and Adivasi, officially called Scheduled Tribes, means ST girls. While non-Muslim girls stays in school for around 4 years, a Muslim girls leave school as early as after 3 years. Now the next is reason for dropping out of school, especially Dalit, Adivasi and Muslim communities. Now there are so many reasons, one by one we will study. Now first is the lack of proper schools and teachers. Now in many parts of our country, especially rural and poor areas, proper schools and regular teachers are not available. The next reason is inaccessible. If the school is not close to people's homes and buses or vans are not available for transport, people will not be willing to send their girls to school. Now the next reason is unaffordable. Many people are poor and unable to afford the cost of education. In such cases, boys are given preference and girls are retained at home. Now the next is discrimination. Now discrimination and resultant harassment by teachers and classmates is also a reason for dropping out. For example, the Dalit writer Om Prakash Valmiki's experience as mentioned in chapter 1. Now the next is women's movement. Now women and girls have a right to go to school. There is a change in the scenario that existed many years ago. This change has not happened overnight. It is a result of the continuous struggle and effort by women individually and collectively. This struggle is called the women's movement. Now, many women's organizations from different parts of the country as well as individual women are a part of this movement. The movement has the support of many men also. Even in other spheres like legal reforms, violence and health, the condition of women has improved. Various strategies and methods are used for spreading awareness, fighting discrimination and seeking justice. Some of the strategies are as follows. First is campaigning. Now, campaigns to oppose discrimination and seek justice are an integral part of the women's movement. The impact of the campaigns is as under. Now, the first is passing of new laws. Now, new laws have been passed as a result of the campaigns. In 2006, a law regarding domestic violence was passed. These laws gave legal protection to women who face physical and mental torture at home. The next is guidelines against sexual harassment. In 1997, the Supreme Court passed guidelines to protect women from sexual harassment at workplace and within educational institutions. Next is amendment in dowry laws. In the 1980s, there was a nationwide campaign against dowry death. Women groups spoke against the failure to take action against the people responsible for dowry death. They took a streets approach, courts, etc. These issues hence gained importance and became an important matter in the newspapers and in the society, hence leading the changes in the dowry laws. Now the second is raising awareness. The first step in addressing any issue is to raise public awareness. The women's movement did the same and spread the message through street plays, songs and public meetings. The next is protesting. When any violation against women takes place, the women's movement raises its voice against it. Some popular and effective ways to drawing public attention to injustices are public rallies and demonstrations. And the last is showing solidarity. Showing solidarity with other women and causes is also a part of women's movement. Women hold up candles to show solidarity between the people of our country. Candlelight vigils to protest against brutal cruelty shown to women are also very common. Now with this, we have covered all the main points of this chapter. With this, have a nice day. Thank you.